First of all, I'd like to thank the organizers for Latin City. Hindi mo naman kapatid si Kuya Kino. For inviting me here kasi naalala ko last year pa namin pinaplano to. Siguro kahalo sa mga pawit na hindi natuloy-tuloy last year. But I'm glad na natuloy this year. And I'd like to thank the organizers for that. My topic today is on sea turtles, pawitan, hindi yung mga pagdabas. Kanina may kausap ako. Kita yung picture sabi sa akin, marami yung daw pagdabas sa Laguna Lake. Iba yung pagdabas sa pawitan, sea turtles. And so I'll be speaking about sea turtles and one of the most important habitat of green sea turtles in the region, which is the Turtle Islands. And then, of course, since there's a lot of talk the past few years about climate change, I'll try to talk a bit about the impacts of climate change on sea turtles and their habitats. First off, just some basic information on sea turtle biology and life history. You know, it's really important that if you engage in conservation of sea turtles, as even other species, it's really important that you have at least your basic knowledge on biology and life histories of this species. So sea turtles, they actually share similar life histories. There are 7 known species, and all of them share similar life histories. They vary slightly among species. They usually migrate from distant feeding grounds to nesting areas. Usually the nesting areas are near nesting habitats. So they migrate there. And that migration usually could be as far as 3,000 kilometers away from their feeding ground. And then there they meet up with their partners. So sometimes the males and the females come from different feeding areas. And they would spend about 1 to 2 months in that mating area to mate. So they would spend during the mating period, a female can actually mate with up to 7 to 9 males. Ganun din yung males. The males can mate with several females over a period of 1 to 2 months. So after mating, the females will rest for 2 to 4 weeks, and they will emerge on the nesting beach. Quite adjacent to their mating habitats, and lay her first clutch of eggs. Okay, usually one clutch of eggs or one nest will contain about 100 eggs. Okay, after this first clutch, they may return 4 to 8 more times during that nesting period to lay again during that season. Okay, but this female turtle will, after that mating season, will also be migrating back to that nesting area or that mating area after 3 to 5 years. So each nest, as I mentioned, contains around 100 eggs, and these eggs will take about 45 to 60 days to incubate and hatch, depending on the temperature of the sand. Okay. And after they hatch to the egg chamber, they don't immediately emerge from the nest. Usually it takes them 2 to 3 days to climb their way up to the surface of the sand. And even when they're already close to the surface, they would stop and sense if the sand temperature is cool enough. That's why you will see most of the time hatchlings emerging at night. That's the time when the sun temperature cools down. And then, pag nag-emerge yan, sabay-sabay, ang dami, about 90% usually hatch and they emerge from the beach. And they flow down the beach and head directly offshore. And they use light, wave direction, as well as yung Earth's magnetic field for guidance. Yeah, if you see turtles or hatchlings emerging from a nest, they would head straight to the waterline because they are fixing their sights on the horizon, which is usually supposed to be the lightest part of this water. And then these hatchlings, they would swim, parang frenzy, for one day, to get as far offshore as possible. And after this, they would float as part of the ocean's plankton for several years until they migrate from oceanic waters onshore to shallow feeding areas. So they become planktonic. And actually, this is still a big question mark for a lot of turtle biologists, where they spend their time during this period. And we call this the lost year habitat. So they're still, they're not yet sure where these turtles go to. But what's really important is, that's why we try to discourage what we call head starting. Because some conservationists or some conservation organizations or associations, they have this idea that if you keep the hatchlings for some time, they would be stronger and be able to avoid their predators. But actually, what they are doing, as we have experienced during a lot of experiments which we conducted during the 1980s, the turtles weaken. Kasi that time after they emerge until they swim out, that's the period where they have all the energy to swim to the right current systems. And that current should bring them where they should be during their lost year period. So it's not really encouraged to keep baby turtles. And also, if you notice, baby turtles would have some source of food in their belly. And that food would last for only about 5 to 7 days, after which they should learn how to feed. So if you keep them long, they reduce that instinct. So after 5 to 10 years, they may grow to juveniles or sub-adults, about 20 to 40 centimeters in length, and they settle down as new recruits in coastal feeding grounds. Okay. So it's very, really rare that you see turtles this size. If you see turtles this size and you're able to document it, please report it to the DNR. Because we are looking for areas where these juveniles actually settle. So this is another big question mark in the life history of our sea turtles. We're not sure if they're getting recruited in coral reefs here in the Philippines, although I've seen some areas even in Manila where we see these small turtles settling on. So these turtles may have several feeding grounds between the first settling site and their adult feeding site. So they may move to different feeding grounds. And then they remain in their feeding grounds for 5 to 10 more years until they reach sexual maturity. So like for green turtles, it usually takes around 25 years before they reach sexual maturity. And this is a very serious challenge for conservation, because you really don't know if your conservation initiatives this year have been successful 10 years from now. You have to really wait for about 25 years to say that yes, we were successful. But our case here in the Philippines, I think we have a good idea that the initiatives that we undertook during the early 80s are now bearing fruit. I'll talk more about that later. So when they reach sexual maturity, they undertake their first migration to the mating areas and nesting areas, which that's essentially the life history of these sea turtles. So just another illustration of the life history. I think I'll just use this one. So if you will notice in this illustration, can you guess which one is the male or female here? Sige nga. Kasi big boy lang ito. Actually, when sea turtles grow to sexual maturity, the males would have longer tails. So, kung nakakita ko yung sea turtles while snorkeling, and you notice that the tail extends beyond the hind fiber, usually that's the male, that's a maturity. So, you'll see here, there's a male and that's a female. So, they migrate long distances most of the time to their mating habitats, and they stay there for about 1 to 2 months. After the males, after the mating season, kung mga lalaki, kung mga lalaki, iwan niya asawa niya, they will migrate back to their feeding grounds. And then the females will stay behind to go to their nesting beaches. Okay, there in the nesting beach, the females will lay eggs usually 4 to 8 times during the season. And after its nesting, the female would swim towards what we call an internesting habitat. Usually within a 40 to 60 kilometer radius from their nesting beach. And then there she would rest again for about 10 to 14 days. And then swim back again to their nesting beach. So she would repeat that cycle about 4 to 8 times during the nesting season. And then after laying up to 8 clutches of eggs, the female again would migrate back to their feeding grounds. So the eggs are left. There's no maternal or paternal care given to the nest. The females will just leave their eggs, and the eggs will hatch. The hatchlings will swim offshore, and then they get caught in oceanic currents where they go through a planktonic stage. And then they would settle in developmental habitats, and then when they grow, they would find their own feeding habitats. So that's the life history. The reason why I'm dwelling on this is this is in fact the basis for a lot of conservation initiatives. For example, in the Sulu-Sulawesi marine ecoregion, which includes Indonesia, Malaysia, and the Philippines, we have created a network of marine protected areas. And that network is composed of several marine protected areas, which are known turtle habitats. So those MPAs, or marine protected areas, some of them are nesting habitats, some of them are feeding areas, some of them are developmental habitats. Because if you really want to conserve the population stock, you need to know this information so that you're targeting the right places and using the proper management interventions. Okay, so are we good with this? We'll have a question and answer later. So here in the Philippines, we have 5 of the 7 known species. You have the green turtle, Ethiopian green. This is the more dominant species in the country. And then the hawksbill. The green is sought after for its meat. According to those who have eaten turtles, this is the best meat. But it's illegal. There's a Philippine Wildlife Act. So. And the hawksbill, as the second dominant species, and the hawksbill is sought after for its carapace, for its shell, because the shells of the hawksbills are very expensive, and these are processed into jewelries. So a lot of smuggling is happening from Sabuanga, Tawi, and we're quite sure they're going to either mainland Asia or Japan. So that's the hawk's bill. Kaya the reason why they're called hawksbill is because of the beak. And then you have the olive ridley. This is what we have in Zambales, Bataan. In fact, the type specimen of olive ridley was taken from Manila Bay, I think during the 1940s or 1950s. But now, you seldom see ridleys in Manila Bay. And then yung mowa. So, na-install ko na yung problem. And then, sorry, that's the loggerhead. Sorry. That's the loggerhead, that's the ridley. This is what we have in Zambales. Loggerheads, we don't have any confirmed report of nesting. Although we have several, we have at least one loggerhead that was caught somewhere in Basilan during the late 80s, which had a tag from Okinawa, Japan. So you can just imagine how far those turtles are migrating. So it, the presence is confirmed, but nesting is not yet confirmed. And the biggest of the seven species is our red lag. Up until last year, there's been no confirmed reports of leatherbacks nesting anywhere in the Philippines. However, there was an exciting incident last year in summer in Legazpi where one leatherback was seen nesting in Legazpi. So that's the first confirmed nesting of leatherbacks in the country. Although leatherbacks are caught occasionally in fishing gears like drift gill nets or purse seiners. But the biggest nesting population right now in the region is somewhere in Indonesia. It used to be in peninsular Malaysia in Terengganu, but that population is now extinct. So all sea turtles are protected species. The CITES, or Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species of Flora and Fauna, lists all marine turtles on Appendix 1. So there are very strict regulations regarding international trade of all species. IUCN, the World Conservation Union, lists like the green turtle as endangered, leatherback and hawksbills as critically endangered, and the olive ridley and loggerhead as vulnerable. I don't know, I'm not sure if there's a new, there's an update on this. Sea turtle populations are going down due to a lot of threats. Harvesting of turtles and their products for food and other uses is still happening within the country and outside of the country. So turtle eggs, the shells are also being processed into jewelries. I think in Sandakan, in Sabah right now, one turtle egg is how much?
Maybe around 30 pesos.
30 pesos per egg. Can you just imagine? And the island, by the way, Orlan was the former coordinator of CI for the Turtle Islands. And the island that we're managing there, Pabuan Island, which I'll show you a photo of later, in 1 year, it can produce up to 1.4 million eggs. So you can just imagine the economics. And that is also making it difficult to conserve or to implement any serious conservation programs there. That's just from one island. A lot of turtles are caught in fishing gears. And one of our major concerns right now are the drift gill nets. Yung mga tinatawag ng ghost nets. A lot of our turtles are actually being caught by foreign fishing vessels, operating mostly between Malabak and northern Sabah in Borneo. Most of these fishing boats come from either Vietnam, from Hainan in China, and from Taiwan. We have records of apprehensions. Sometimes one drift unit can catch up to about 120 turtles in one day. And these fishermen know exactly where to lay the nets and what time of the year they are passing through those areas. Light is a problem for sea turtles, particularly for emerging hatchlings. They get disoriented. So if you have bright lights behind the nesting beach, the hatchlings would tend to walk or crawl towards your light instead of swimming towards the sea. And in many countries where nesting habitat is close to busy streets, actually the hatchlings get run over by a lot of vehicles. Coastal development, this is actually what happened to the once largest population of leatherbacks in Terengganu, Malaysia. Because of the turtles, they developed a basin that it was really poorly planned and was not managed until the turtles actually lost their habitat. Now, if you go to Terengganu, you'll see a lot of five-star resorts without any business. Foraging grounds are lost to destructive fishing. It's happened. There's still a lot of dynamite fishing and cyanide fishing. Reclamation is also a problem, and sediment runoff. Pollution, this is a major issue, particularly marine debris, plastics, which turtles recognize as jellyfish sometimes. And a lot of them ingest plastics that they ingest that. Lack of resources for adequate enforcement. We have a lot of laws and regulations that protect sea turtles. Unfortunately, the problem is that these laws are not enforced. So you'll still see turtle eggs, especially if you go to the markets in Tawi-Tawi, if you go to Sabah in Malaysia, in Terengganu market, you'll still see turtle eggs. Actually, you don't eat the chibis with the turtles. What's in turtle eggs here? Anybody? The turtle eggs look like ping pong balls, but they're leathery. And I must confess, I've eaten turtle eggs in the past. The yellow part actually is quite greedy, and the albumen, the white part, it doesn't get hard even if you boil it for a long time. So what you usually do, you boil this, and then you peel a bit, you make a small hole, and what we usually do before, we would have nor seasoning. And then you just suck the egg from the shell. That's a confession. Then before, we were doing a lot of experiments on hatcheries. After arranging all the eggs in all of the holes in the hatchery, we would have some leftovers. So those eggs would die anyway. So because the eggs are very sensitive after 2 hours. Before 2 hours, you can actually roll the egg, and it won't damage the development. But after 2 hours, the vest of the vessel start to form, and even if you tilt it, it will be keeping away. So if you're moving turtle eggs, make sure you do it within the vest within 2 hours. Poaching is a problem. We've had a lot of cases, and we've done a lot of apprehensions, as I mentioned, mostly from. There's a fleet from China, from Hainan, that have been apprehended many times. Some of the boats have been apprehended 2 times already, the same crew, the same boat. I think that's apprehended, red-handed, with these turtles. But when they arrive in Puerto Princesa, some of our government agencies intervene already. The files don't get filed, the case don't get filed. The perpetrators are just asked to leave with their boats. And the following year, you'll see them again in near to Patahari, which is a World Heritage Site. It's still happening up to now. This is in El Nido, in Palawan. Well within our territory. And there were about 140 hawksbills. These are all hawksbills, which are very, very expensive parrotfish. And the fishermen are from Vietnam. Another threat, as I mentioned earlier, it's really important that you understand the biology, the ecology, and the life history of this of the species you're trying to conserve. And I mentioned earlier, there are still a lot of question marks on the life history of sea turtles, particularly on the lost year habitat, where we don't know where they are drifted to by oceanic currents. We don't have sufficient information on their migratory routes, where they swim, what paths they use from their nesting place to their feeding areas. So there's still a lot of gaps in the knowledge, but we're using the best available science to develop and implement management programs. Of course, recently there's been a lot of talk also about climate change. This climate is also impacting on sea turtles. I'll talk more about that in a while. So that's on the species. The next part of my topic will be on the Turtle Islands. But before I go to my slides, I'd like to show you a very short video about the Turtle Islands. This was produced by Conservation International with other partners, and the footages were taken by the National Geographic photographer. Arlan and I worked with the photographer for 3 weeks on the island in 2001. And this is part of a
you are looking at an unlikely ambassador, the driving force behind an agreement between two nations to save their habitat. These little guys are the reason that two countries came together to form a transboundary marine sanctuary, the Turtle Islands Heritage Protected Area. Stretching across a small chain of 9 islands at the border of Malaysia and the Philippines, the park is one of the largest turtle nesting sites in the world. On one island alone, 900,000 turtle eggs are laid each year, thanks in large part to hatcheries and protected habitats. But these animals have not always had it easy. Turtles and their eggs have long been a staple of island diets.
Historically, turtles were food for people for many, many years. People probably paddled across to a new island and, you know, they ate fish forever, and then all of a sudden here comes a turtle, which was a plentiful source of food and protein.
Over centuries, the once plentiful population of sea turtles plummeted. But in 1977, a foundation was laid to bring these turtles back. On the Malaysian island of Sabah, the local government bought 3 islands and created the Turtle Island Park. A few miles away in the Philippines, researchers discovered that the turtles on their beaches migrated to other islands, including those of their Malaysian neighbors.
It was clear that these turtles actually do not recognize any boundaries. They don't need passports to cross to the other side.
In 1996, Malaysia and the Philippines established one of the world's first transboundary marine protected areas.
initially it was quite difficult, but if you have a very open mind and we trust each other, things can actually move forward.
The cooperation between nations has led to improvements in the health of the entire ecosystem. And the turtles are becoming an attraction, bringing in ecotourism and new sources of income to local communities.
We have been providing alternative sources of livelihood for the community here to win at least some of them away from their dependence on turtle eggs as a source of income. And we're now seeing more members of the community asking to be part of the program.
These diplomatic turtles have brought two countries together. As a result, their numbers are coming back and their unique habitat is being restored.
The Malaysian and Philippines Islands Complex is just a stunning example of important beaches that are being protected by governments with the support of research and conservation agencies. And those turtle populations today are reflective of how effective that management is. The numbers are growing, they're stable, and that's the sort of thing that we'd like to see happening all over the planet.
This map shows you Philippine Turtle Islands Wildlife Sanctuary. This was established through a presidential proclamation. And this line actually represents the border between Sabah and the Philippines. So these islands are really very close to Sandakan in Sabah. Normally we would fly to Kota Kinabalu, and then another short flight to Sandakan, and we take a speedboat to cross the border. And it takes us only 40 minutes to reach the Philippine side. So on the Philippine side, you have six main islands. And this green island here is Dibaguan Island. This is the strict protection zone where we have been working for many. It's almost 30 years already. And this is the eggs produced here represents about 70% of the total egg production in the entire Turtle Islands. So the Turtle Islands Wildlife Sanctuary was declared in 1999. It covers the entire municipality of the Turtle Islands, so that the entire protected area, about 242,000 hectares, actually represents the entire municipality of the Turtle Islands. So there are six islands: Taganak, Baguan, Langahan, Buwan, Dihiman, Great Bakungan, with a total area of 242. Out of the 242,000 hectares, only 308 hectares actually correspond to the land portion. So the islands are quite small. The human population there is now more than 6,000. Actually fishing contributes about 62% to the total income of households, while turtle egg collection contributes about 37%. So this Turtle Islands Wildlife Sanctuary is now being managed by a Protected Area Management Board. In fact, I've sat on the board since, I think, 2000, up to before I left Conservation International in 2001. There is a protected area superintendent based on the island. There's still a lot of issues and concerns in the area. Turtle egg collection is still happening despite the issuance of the Philippine Wildlife Act. Technically, it's a violation of the Republic Act, but the local government is still issuing permits for some community members to gather a certain percentage of the turtle eggs. destructive fishing activity still occurs in especially in the smaller islands. IUU fishing, we have apprehended already a Chinese fishing boat here from Hainan. Lack of political will. A lot of the local politicians there actually also they also see turtle eggs as an important source of income. It's really that. So the laws are not really being enforced. The border is very porous, as you've seen in the map. You can easily cross the border. Lack of funds for the management of the protected area. Very limited sources of other sources of income for the community. And the area is an important navigational route for it's a major shipping lane, actually. And a lot of garbage are being done by a lot of these boats. Also, the garbage from Sabah sometimes, depending on the direction of the wind during southwest monsoon, a lot of the garbage from Sabah are being transported to the islands. There's also some issues on that area. But Turtle Islands Wildlife Sanctuary is an important nesting ground. This is, we believe, the largest aggregation of nesting wind turtles in the entire ASEAN region, maybe even the Asia Pacific region. They produce about 2.5 million eggs every year. And Bakuan Island, Green Islands, the Green Island, as I showed earlier, accounts for about 70% of the egg production in the Turtle Islands Wildlife Sanctuary. So this simple map, I'm just showing you so you can appreciate the spread of the islands along the border. The Malaysian side has three islands as part of their Turtle Islands Park. On our side, this is the Turtle Islands Wildlife Sanctuary. The islands on the Malaysian side are much smaller than the Philippine Islands, but you can see how close the islands are to each other. In fact, you can easily cross from one island to the other. And you can also imagine our turtles laid out nesting here, moving back and forth across the border without any need for passports or visas. So this area, or the joint management area, which is the Turtle Islands Heritage Protected Area, was created through a bilateral agreement between the governments of the Philippines in May of 1996. And this became the world's first transboundary protected area for green turtles. We don't know of any other transboundary protected area for green turtles. So I'm guessing this is still the only transboundary protected area. Management is shared by both countries, making possible the conservation of habitats of sea turtles over a large area, independent of their territorial boundaries. Actually, the TIPA was a recipient of the 20th Paul Getty Wildlife Conservation Prize in 1997. After the agreement was signed in 1996, the following year it became a recipient of the Paul Getty Award. And that was the first time the Paul Getty gave $250,000 for one for Malaysia and one for the Philippines. Usually they only give $50,000. But since we argued to Paul Getty, there are two countries here, so don't tell us to split the $50,000. So that was the first time they gave $100,000 for the Paul Getty Award in 1997. So the Turtle Islands Heritage Protected Area is a natural laboratory where scientists can study many different aspects of sea turtle habitats, including geology. The active coastal processes here are quite interesting. Oceanography, marine biology, even reef ecology, fisheries biology, and sociology. However, it is famous, of course, for the turtles. And the area supports a remarkable diversity of marine fauna, notably corals and fishes, as well as some species of terrestrial plants, birds, and other reptiles. Talking by our then I was working within. We were going to the islands once, at least once a year, staying there for 3 to 4 months. That was during the early 80s. And our per diem at that time was 60 pesos a day. And it took us at that time about 2 to 3 weeks before we reached the islands. So you can just imagine the 60 pesos per day. This would be get stranded in San Juan, we get stranded in Cagayan, Tawi-Tawi. By the time we get to the islands, there's no more money. And we have to stay there for another 3 months. And we always find ourselves in a dilemma. Because on the island, there were so many monitor lizards. They were eating our turtle eggs. But we were also thinking the monitor lizards are also protected species. But most of the time, when we eliminate the protein, we will get one or two. And sure enough, whenever we open up the monitor lizard, there will be at least 40 turtle egg shells inside. There's still monitor lizards there, don't worry. The agreement that was signed by the Philippine government and the Malaysian government identified the 4 priority activities for collaboration: management-oriented research, establishment of centralized database and information network, appropriate information awareness program, marine turtle resource management, protection, and appropriate ecotourism program. So there are 5 activities. And in that agreement, the 2 countries also decided to create a joint management committee to serve as the body that would oversee the overall direction of the collaboration. And in fact, I've sat in that committee since the agreement was signed. Now that I'm not at sea, I sometimes invite me as, I don't know, as a senior citizen, as a technical advisor. Okay, that's it for the turtles and the turtle islands. I will now go to the last part of my topic, which is the impacts of climate change. Turtles are reptiles, and reptiles are also affected by the climate change. But the first one I'd like to mention is sea level rise. There are projections, I'm not sure if these projections are correct, but even a small rise in sea level could result in a large loss of beach nesting habitat. We have seen this happen in the Turtle Islands since many years back, and it's still happening. We're seeing a lot of erosion. In fact, one of the islands on the Malaysian side, Pulisan Island, which is known for a large aggregation of oxbills nesting in the area, the island is really disappearing. And we are worried where those hostels will be nesting. We're just hoping they will go to the Philippine side so we'll have more hostels. So this is what happens when the nesting breeds gets eroded. And you can just imagine the smallest island on the Malaysian side is only 2 hectares. And if there's a lot of erosion, you will really lose your nesting beaches. This is a Google shot of Baguan Island, where we have been working for a long time. This island is about 34 hectares, and there is a continuous nesting beaches of about 1.2 kilometers around the island. So all of this white sand that you see here are actually nesting habitats. And 2 years ago, I think there were about 1.4 million eggs. 1.7 million eggs on this island alone. If you come here during the peak nesting season from July to about October, it's easy to see at least 100 turtles every night coming at the beach. Sometimes I was shocked to see about 104, 120 that evening. It was about 3 years ago. Another impact relates to the temperature. Hotter summers mean higher sun temperatures, which can actually lead to changes in sex ratios or even prevent eggs from hatching. Since these are reptiles also, and a lot of scientists have studied this, and this is called the sex temperature-dependent sex determination. They have identified that the pivotal temperature, for example, for green turtles, is about 29.2 degrees. This means that if during the incubation period the temperature goes higher than 29.2, you can be sure that most, if not all, of your hatchlings inside that nest will all be females. So if you increase the temperature during the middle third period of incubation, that one day, if you change the temperature, you'll change the sex. And we've done a lot of experiments on this during the early 80s with some funding from the Swiss and Wildlife. And we've seen the mistakes that we have been doing because during that time we were maintaining a lot of hatcheries on the island. And we got worried when we heard about this temperature dependent sex determination. So with some funding from the Fish and Wildlife of the U.S., we determined the sex ratio of hatchlings coming out from our nest, from our hatcheries. And sure enough, it was 100% females. And we were doing that already for about 3 years before we did the study. And a similar thing happened to the leatherback population in Tonga. Because during the 70s, when the tourism was at its peak, they also maintained a lot of hatcheries, and the hatcheries were all out under the sun. So what we actually did during the time, as I said, with very little budget, per gem was only 60 pesos, we tried to shade some parts of the hatchery using coconut leaves. And with funding also from the U.S. Fish and Wildlife, we were monitoring the sex ratio. And we found we can actually manipulate the sex ratio using coconut leaves. Sana ganun din ang mga tao. So that's the potential impact and real impact of climate change to sea turtles. The other, which relates also to temperature, is the limit of incubation temperature. If you exceed 34 degrees, all those eggs die. They will not develop and they will not hatch. Okay. The other impact of hot summers, which we have also seen in the Turtle Islands, is if it has been too hot during that period, the sun becomes very dry, and you will pity those nesting females when they try to dig their egg chambers, because the egg chambers get caving in, and sometimes it would take a female 4 hours before she can really dig a good egg chamber, because they need moisture in the sun so that they can form a proper egg chamber. So when it's really dry, they have a hard time. Of course, we've heard a lot about this already, coral bleaching due to warm ocean temperatures. We've seen this a lot. This happens a lot in the Philippines, even in our place in Anilao. We've seen this, although I think we're quite blessed in Anilao because after a bleaching event, we always see those coral reefs there rebound after 2 to 3 months. Of course, we know that the corals are also habitats and feeding areas for sea turtles. important for this species. Changes in ocean currents can modify migration paths and feeding patterns and disrupt the annual cycle on which the species have relied on for millions of years. This is an example of the migration of one individual from the Turtle Islands using satellite tracking. She ended up in Malabang from the Turtle Islands. Another one from the Turtle Islands ended up somewhere in Tawi. We have a lot of satellite tracking data which shows that our turtles can actually migrate across West Philippine Sea, South China Sea, as far as Pacific Islands. So they move a lot in long distances. These are data from turtles from the Luan Islands and Turtle Islands migrating into different parts of the Philippines. So this area is actually supplying turtles all over the country and the region. In terms of rainfall, more extreme rainfall can raise groundwater and thereby flooding nests. Kaya minsan, sometimes if you see nests even laid on below the low tide mark, we have to remove those nests because if the tide comes in, the eggs will drown. So when you have a lot of rainfall, it happens also that the nests get deflated and it will, the eggs will not develop. I think this is my last, this is the last time. This is a video again, and hopefully it will create more awareness on the importance of turtles and why we really need to conserve them. This was also shot in the Turtle Islands.
Southeast Pacific by nine islands designated as a marine sanctuary, the Turtle Islands Heritage Protected Area. By protecting sea turtle nesting areas here, biodiversity has returned to levels not seen since the 1950s.
But what if people ask me, what is it about? Why are they so important? Think about it. Children go out on the beach and they start being catching on the beach, running down to the oceans. It's the cutest thing in the world. They go, but you have done. One of the great things about the Turtle Islands site is the sheer number of turtles and the fact that they nest all year round. Turtle Islands, you can see a turtle any day of the year. And that means you can build a wonderful tourism program around it. And you can guarantee that your guests are going to see a turtle. You can't do that in other places. Just imagine what turtles are worth to the tourism industry. You know, that money isn't used once. That money is used many, many times. It's an incredible value. Sea turtles can be used as a selling point for much wider issues to do with conservation.
Conservation programs employ rangers and researchers, and ecotourism creates service jobs in retail sales. When turtles thrive, the entire community is rewarded. But it's not just the human residents that benefit. Turtles also play a role in the marine ecology.
Green turtles are herbivores. They feed on seagrass, just like grass in a house. The more you cut it, the healthier it looks, the faster it grows. Now get this, seagrass beds are nursery grounds for fish and shrimp. So seagrasses are important to sea turtles, but at the same time, they're important to the commercial fisheries upon which humans rely.
The iconic sea turtle leads the way for a host of conservation initiatives.
Protecting sea turtles means we're protecting oceans, we're protecting coral reefs, the migratory routes that turtles depend on. And that is ultimately what's going to save the planet by having healthy oceans. And sea turtles can help us get there.
and even raising money for sea turtle conservation, because it's been really difficult to raise money. That's why we have the only fundraising strategy. Thank you very much.
The floor is now open for our audience to direct their questions. Any questions? You can use the microphones on the aisles.
Don't be shy. Recipes for sea turtles.
How do you turn the eggs into jewelry?
Actually, the part of the turtle that they process into jewelry is a carapace.
I thought that.
Especially from hawksbills, because the shells are thicker.
Oh, the shells.
Yeah, and they're very expensive. Sometimes you see designer eyeglasses which uses hawksbill shells. They're very expensive. Bracelets. I have a turtle here, but it's not. It's a rhino.
Yes.
Since no one is, I think, starting to ask questions, I would like to thank. Thank you for a very nice presentation. This is my first time that I learned so much about turtles. I was wondering what they feed on, but of course it was shown that they feed on grasses, sea grasses. I would like to know what are the other predators, excluding the humans and the of course you mentioned the reptiles that eat eggs. So what are the other predators that they encounter in the sea? And are they are there also some diseases that affects them?
Thank you very much for asking the question. Very interesting. In fact, turtles have a lot of predators depending on the stage in their life history. Even during incubation, when it's still in its nest, a lot of, particularly even in the islands that we're managing, there's a lot of ghost crabs. These are small crabs, and they could dig into the nest, and they would eat the eggs. The problem with that is that when you damage one, two eggs, the fluids that go down to the rest of the eggs in the chamber will also be damaged. And a lot of other problems in the so the balance incubation, you have a lot of predators that monitor lizards. I think that's why they're called monitor lizards. Even how good the turtle can hide their eggs, the monitor lizard, they always locate the eggs. So they dig and they eat up to in one sitting, maybe 20, 30 eggs. Of course, after they emerge, again, there are other predators on the beach, and seabirds that feed on them. When they reach the water, then you have a lot of huge, large pelagic fishes. Even the demersals like the groupers, they would feed on hot snakes. Sharks are also a major predator. So there's a lot. Sea turtle experts estimate that about 1% only grow to sexual maturity because of the lack of predators and lack of threats as they grow to sexual maturity. By the way, the feeding habits actually differ among different species. Green turtles, when they grow mature, they are herbivores, so they will feed on sea grasses. However, when they are still juveniles or some adults, they are still omnivores, so they have mixed diet. not like me or I'm a carnivore. So, but they change. The house males are also carnivores, so they feed on sponges and invertebrates. So different species have different diets. Does that answer your question, sir? Yes, sir.
Thank you for your very nice presentation. When several times I traveled from Manila to Mindanao, and in somewhere between the islands in the Visayas, we noticed turtles swimming. Are these native to the Philippines or they are visitors?
Thank you for that question also. Actually, it's difficult to tell. That is one reason why we tag turtles, so that they have markers. But as I mentioned earlier, these turtles can migrate long distances, up to 5,000 kilometers from the feeding ground to the nesting beaches. So it's really difficult to say where the turtle is from if we see it in the wild, unless there are, it has tags or maybe there are genetic studies on the animal. But as I've shown earlier in one of the slides, a lot of the turtles that nest in the Philippine Turtle Islands, they migrate in a lot of areas within the Philippines, even as far as the Pacific Island. We have had a lot of tag recoveries in the Visayas from the Philippine Turtle Islands. So probably about 500, 600 kilometers away from the nesting beach.
Another question. In your research on these turtles, have you determined how many females could one male mate during the mating period? So that, are they like the Muslims who have more wives?
More. Actually, we have not been able to do that study, but there's a lot of literature out there on mating, and based on the literature, one female during the mating season can mate with up to 9 males, and sometimes one mating could last up to almost 70 hours. One male and one female. That's why when I was trying to raise money when I was with the WWF Philippines as country director, the WWF Japan country director came to the Philippines. I gave a presentation on sea turtle biology. He was about 75 years old at that time. And when I started talking about mating of sea turtles, he got so interested. Especially when I said that they can mate up to 70 hours, one pair. And after my presentation, they gave me $50,000. He asked me if he can be a turtle, but he gets reincarnated.
Yes, Dr. Bakay, my idol.
Thank you, Romy. You're also my idol. It's from the management perspective, it's the common list of problems, of political will, and but what struck me was in Baguhan, it's really the lack of alternative livelihood. But from your experience, how have you addressed that and to provide, you know, alternative livelihoods for you?
Thank you. The community actually lives in the 5 islands. There are 6 islands in the Turtle Islands. Baguhan is a strict protection zone, so there's no community there. Most of the inhabitants are in the Taganak, which is the seat of the municipal government. And livelihood programs have been a major challenge. Even when I was still with WWF, it's difficult to succeed in and to sustain these livelihood programs. However, we have implemented some, and I think one of the most successful was with the youth, the ones that were that were shown in the video where they produce t-shirts. But for some reason, you know, these livelihood programs, if you don't really handhold them, you really strictly monitor and enforce the agreements with the beneficiaries, they would tend to fail. That's why one of the initiatives that we've been trying to push for in the Critical Islands is the serious ecotourism development program. We have done an ecotourism development plan, and this has been approved already by the Protected Area Management Board. As for the longest time, this group of islands have been neglected by our national government. You won't believe, sometimes you ask the community to put the president in the Philippines, they don't know. Yeah, they are begging for economic and we believe that ecotourism and sea turtle conservation can be a perfect marriage. Up to now, you know, our foreign affairs is a bit busy with challenges, our challenges. In fact, we wanted to show the bilateral agreement between the Philippines and Malaysia as a potential model for what's happening in the South China Sea and the Philippines. It's hard. I've had a lot, organized a lot of meetings with those agencies, sometimes multi-agency meetings, and they would say yes, but after the meeting they would not. So the people there are left to fend for themselves. And it's sad because there's a lot of potential for tourism. We've seen that on the Sabah side and the Malaysian side, where they have only three very small islands. But every year, all the rooms, all the beds are always fully booked. And they always have spillovers. And that's why except the director of Sabah Parks, was my contemporary during the 80s of the Virgin Islands. It's been begging, so you better build your facilities. We'll make sure we fill up all your beds every year. But our government's not moving. So I think that's one of the best livelihood product that we can sell. It's to benefit, definitely benefit a lot of the communities.
I just would like to add some good idea on the ecotourism. It seems to me that revenues will be coming more to Sabah rather than the Philippines in relation to the ecotourism. Not only maybe you have some route through Balarap Strait or Philippine side to get more revenues out of this ecotourism. Thank you.
Actually, that's a very interesting. If you look at this map, this is the Philippine side, right? We have six islands, we have bigger islands, we have more turtles. And these are just the three nesting islands in Sabah. The tourists are coming from Sandakan. There are concessionaires that manage the resort facilities here. And the maximum capacity of the facilities here is just 50. 50 tourists a night. And you can just imagine if you open this up. Just the spillover from these three islands. And it will be much easier if the tourists can cross directly from here to here. Because if you go through Balarap, that means you fly from Manila, Puerto Princesa, you travel by land to Balarap, which is 1 hour 45 minutes. You take a short flight to Sandakan here, 30 minutes, 40 minutes. You take a speedboat across here, 40 minutes. So in the same day, you can visit Greater Islands. But the thing is, the government should work with Malaysia on this. Because there are sensitive issues here, like last year, the misadventure of our sultan in Lahat Apulu that created a lot of tension with Malaysia. We had a hard time going back from Sudan. Although last October I was able to get a person from the Eastern Sub Security Command. They allowed us to cross. But the German embassy here, since we were consultants from GSA, they did not allow us over to Malaysia at the same time. But it took a while before we were able to operate with them. So there's the best, for me, the best way to develop tourism is to use Sandakan as a takeoff of the technologies. Although there's also potential for riverboard diving, because the best diving season in Putatahar is around March to April, May, June. From June, a lot of the dive boats are not doing anything. What we were proposing to the Department of Tourism was to send the dive boats in Mugao. Let the local tourists board from Mugao and then travel to the Greater Islands. It would take them maybe about 16 hours. And during that period, when it's lean months in Tuwala, that's the best season of the year. Because if you notice, this area is on the leeward side of the southwest monsoon. So it's very calm in this area during the months of July or the September, when it is very rough in the season.
More questions? Okay, so that wraps up our open forum.